Hello, everybody. Welcome to the first of three things of a subscriber special that I'm going to be doing for my YouTube channel. And this is going to be a guide on how to play Galactic Conquest in the most optimized way possible for Battlefront 2. So, let's get to it. First things first, you got these four teams, right? Rebels go against Empire, Confederates going against Republic. You will never see Empire versus Confederates or Republic versus Rebellion. That doesn't happen, unfortunately. Now, with this in mind, let us first go and click Republic. Don't worry, I'm not even going to be playing the game other than to demonstrate some stuff. So, I just need to show you that this is the most standardized team. Going with the Republic is the safest bet for a first time playthrough of Battlefront 2's Galactic Conquest. So, what do we see here? We got this spaceship and the galaxy, and there's all these planets and stuff. Like, what does all this mean? What does all this mean? Okay, well, let's go with the obvious. This blue planet is yours, your spaceship's hovering over it, that's your fleet. And there's these two other planets under your control. Your objective, of course, is to conquer all the other planets. Now, how do you do that? And what are the things we need to know before you strategize? Well, what is important? Well, I'm going to go over what I'm just immediately seeing right here and right now. So, you have credits, right? And credits are important. They're money. It's the money that can give you a lot of the leading edges in the conquests you want to make. Money isn't everything. Being a good player, even with no advantages purchased by money, can still probably win you the game. Even if you purchase nothing, you could probably still win the game. But that's not fun. You wanna take advantage of everything. So. Whenever you start Galactic Conquest, you're given a random selection of three planets. Semi-random, anyways. Some things that are always going to be the same. Kamino, as clones, will always be yours. Geonosis will always be yours if you're playing the Confederates. And the other two teams have their own capitals. For instance, over here, this is Hoth, and over here is Endor. Hoth, of course, belongs to the Rebels. Endor belongs to the Empire. These don't show up in the Republic versus Confederate scenarios, so they're just blank spots that you can travel to. Now, with that in mind, each planet, besides the capital planet, gives you a planetary bonus of 30 credits every time you have a planet battle. Okay? So, let's say you fight some dudes on Megiddo and you win. You have the victory bonus of 500 plus the planetary bonus of every planet you have added on to that. So I have 1,000 credits. If I take this over, I get 500, becomes 1,500, and then I would have Megiddo, Coruscant, Geonosis, and Naboo, which you can barely see over here. So capital planets are going to give you 100 credits. If you captured your enemy's capital, you don't get a bonus for that. Keep that in mind. But you would still get a 1,000 credit victory bonus if you were to capture it. Planets, normally, when you capture them, they give you a victory bonus of either 500 or 600 credits. So, the more planets you take, the more credits you get simply for battling. Even if you lose a battle, if you have most of the planets, you'd get a lot. So right now, if I was to take over Megiddo and win, even though I won, the Confederates are going to end up getting a lot of money just because of all the land they had. So it's important that you don't waste any time and keep letting the Confederates attack for you. Try and pick a path in which you capture as many planets as fast as possible, with like in few amount of turns as possible. You can only move 1 point at a time. So from here to here, that's 1 point. From here to here, that's another point. Right? So with that in mind, if I was to attack Megiddo when the Confederates lose, they get 200 credits. 200 credits is constant no matter what the planet is they're fighting. If they lose, you get 200 credits. They get 200 credits. And they get their planetary bonus. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 planets. I think they got it. Maybe I missed one. And 7 times 3 is 210 plus Geonosis. That's 100 planets. That's 310 credits. So 310 plus the 200, they got 510 credits just because they lost. Now, what do you do with credits? Why is it so important that you get them? Well, ignore bonus. The first thing you should really be thinking about is units. As you know, Battlefront 2 is a class-based game. It is a class-based shooter. And each class that you want to recruit costs 1,000 credits, besides the default one, which you always have. You will always have this shooter guy, the guy with the assault rifle. And all classes will have some dude with an automatic assault rifle type of thing, even if it's not explicitly called that. It shoots at a decent rate, has got decent damage, infantry to infantry combat at its most simplest form in this game is by these dudes shooting the other rifle dudes in the game. When you start the game, both sides will only have this until they start purchasing the other classes. Another thing of note is that if you've seen any campaign footage, if you've played this game at all, you know these guys have their pistol and their 4 grenades, and that's pretty important because that's important because, you know, those grenades not only can kill people, they can help whittle down the health of vehicles. Now, well, this is obvious. If everyone has them, why do I have to point it out? Actually, they don't. They don't all have them. 3 out of 4 teams have them, but for some reason, the Confederates don't. The Confederates, they have those super battle droids, those robots. The robot dude, he has his automatic gun, but instead of a pistol, he has this terrible shotgun thingy. It shoots like three rounds in like a shotgun spread. That gun overheats really quickly, like way faster than the pistol, even if it's slightly more effective for like the first two guys you want to shoot. And then instead of grenades, they have this wrist rocket thingy that just is awful in almost every way. It's only good if you're a terrible player who wants to insta-kill one guy, but couldn't be bothered to understand the principles of splash damage or area of effect. A grenade can kill up to like 5 people in this game, especially in tight corridors, but the wrist rocket can only kill like 1 or 2. There is some splash damage from it, but it's just a joke. It's very minimal in comparison. That's why you should be glad that you choose Republic, because not only you have a decent, you know, starter soldier, you have also a weakened enemy in some respects. And another thing about those wrist rockets is that they don't travel very fast, so you can usually dodge them if you know what you're, if you see them get fired. They can, you can only get, if you're a good player, you'll only get killed by them if you got shot from behind. So next dude, the heavy trooper, he's got a rocket launcher, he's got his pistol, two grenades, but the most important thing is his mines. Now,
all fleets awaiting orders, sir.
In every single planet here, except Geonosis for the Confederates, and Hoth for the Rebel versus Empire fight, you know what these guys have? You know what these guys have? They got mines. And you know how powerful mines are? They're more powerful than the rocket launcher for whatever reason. They can basically insta-kill any vehicle you want. If you see a vehicle, you place the mine, it blows it up. Usually just one mine is enough to destroy it. And so suicide attacks with these guys are a completely viable strategy. In fact, you can, of course, you know, decide to have friendly fire off and completely break the game this way. There's only two vehicles that are resistant to that mine that can withstand the damage. I mentioned Geonosis because the clones have the AT-AT or whatever. It's not the AT-AT. This is called something else. AT-AT or whatever. And the stormtroopers on Hoth have those AT-ATs, though, those walker thingies. And even then, I mean, you can still do a lot of damage. And those vehicles aren't even traditional vehicles. Like, they're already OP, so it's no, and you only see them in like those two maps. So this guy is pretty important. If you hate vehicles and you want to cause trouble, you really, really need them. Because the rocket launcher is one thing. The AI will do their thing with it, but usually they won't use their mines. But if you want to destroy stuff really badly, then the mines will be pretty cool. So next, we got the sniper. That's self-explanatory, other than he has that defense turret or whatever. You don't care about that. It's not really that useful. But what it is nice for is if...
Please select a fleet to command.
If you're trying to invade... If someone's trying to invade this planet, if they're trying to invade Kamino, then you're basically free to wreak havoc, because what happens is that Kamino has a lot of turrets and all that stuff that the droids will get into, and then you just shoot them, and they don't make any attempt to dodge because turrets are stationary. Same can be said in certain other maps if they have turrets, like Geonosis has a couple. Coruscant, you can build them on the business Coruscant. And then, yeah, those are some interesting maps where they have a lot of practical use. Oh, yeah, Megiddo too. And then let's see the engineer. This guy is the most broken class in the entire game. Before I get to him, actually, I want to mention these four classes, aside what I mentioned for the main soldier, have basically no differences amongst the other teams. So if you're playing as droids, stormtroopers, or the rebels, they're all going to behave the same way. Well, anyways, back to the engineer. These guys are broken for several reasons. First of all, the shotgun is a decent weapon, and can also, in the right circumstance, basically kill anything in one hit if you're at point blank range. But besides that, they have the ability to not only repair vehicles, which is useful in itself, you can also just invade enemy vehicles by just standing near them by using that that knife they have, that engineering knife they have or whatever it's called. You just stand near them and use it for long enough. And then you can just get in, no questions asked, after you wait a few seconds. Slicing, they call it. But I'm still not done. Besides all those features, though, those main features I mentioned, the det packs are also moderately better than using thermal detonators when you blow stuff up. You get three of them. But here's the funny thing. You don't actually have three of them. You have 18. You can have up to 18 of those, which means that assuming no one started shooting you yet and you haven't gotten distracted, you can just raise terror on any enemy vehicle by planting 18 of those. Not all at once, of course. That's maybe a limiting factor. Just uninterrupted. 18 jet packs. Why? Because in the other inventory slot, he has the ability to give himself more ammunition and heal himself. So, assuming you're doing this right, I'm pretty sure it gives... Okay, maybe it's not 18. Maybe it's, 13. Because I think the ammo you give yourself is 2 jet packs per package he gives himself. He has those canisters for health and ammo. He can drop them and pick them up. Even though that was a tool meant to help other players, if this is multiplayer or the AI teammates in Galactic Conquest, usually that's not what players use them for. They just heal themselves and give themselves more ammo. And that makes him amazing for many reasons. The engineer does everything you want. You can shoot, you can repair, you can destroy, and you can heal. It does everything. Now this is the I'll skip these two guys for now. You know, it would be kind of weird if this game didn't have any battles that took in space. That would be kind of weird. So, of course, you're going to have two classes dedicated primarily for space battles. But the thing is, I don't recommend you recruiting this guy. This guy, the Marine, it's Clone Marine here, or it's going to be called maybe Stormtrooper Marine for the Empire, or Droid Marine, it doesn't matter, in the other team. This is just terrible. Don't bother, because there's only one application for them. It says highly effective saboteurs. This doesn't apply. In fact, they might be worse than the pilot in some ways. This is only useful to the player. We're playing Galactic Conquest, right? So the only physical person that's going to be playing in your game, unless maybe you're on Xbox or PS2, which you can do split screen multiplayer, is going to be you. You're the only one who's going to benefit from this. And it costs 800 credits, which is almost as much as the other classes. And it's just terrible. You want to know why it's terrible? Because these guys can't repair their own ships when they're flying, but the pilot can. So, you know what happens when half your team can't repair their own ships? They're going to die a lot quicker. And that means the enemy team is going to win a lot quicker. Of course, it doesn't mean immediate doom, because there's more to it than just shooting each other's fighters. There's more important objectives that reward more points. But this is basically sabotaging yourself if you recruit this. The only advantage is the gun he's carrying plus a rocket launcher. But that automatic gun that allows you to shoot the enemy's pilots and other Marines if they have any isn't really that important, because it's very easy for a pilot to get a much better pistol by getting rewarded the precision pistol. And I can demonstrate that a bit later. I'll demonstrate some of these things later. So, yeah, this is terrible. Do not bother with this. Just keep the pilot. The pilot has 3 time bombs. Like, they had their bombs on a 5-second timer. You can plant them wherever you need to. if you plant them on a fighter ship and like an enemy fighter ship and they're about to take off, like they're already in it and they're about to take off, it'll destroy them. You get free 4 points, like immediately. It's not, oh, did you damage it first? No. You place one bomb, they take off, they're dead. Or if they're still sitting there and they want to take, they haven't taken off yet, they're dead. And of course, you only need three of those bombs to destroy, if you're trying to destroy the engines from the inside or the life support. So that's interesting. You don't, you really don't need this guy, especially if you have any semblance of skill. So now we have the two special classes. This is where all the differences start, between the different four different teams. These cost 800 credits more than any of the other classes, and not only that, they have anywhere from limited use case to really, really, really special and helpful. And in the case of the clone team, their main downfall is that they're not really that special. They're kind of niche. You think this guy with a minigun on his shoulder would actually be pretty useful, and he maybe could be, but if you're trying to actually play as them, you'll find out that you'll probably destroy more of the enemy as the default soldier than you would using this guy's gun, even though it has like infinite ammo. Well, ammo isn't really a problem for the default soldier. Or someone will say, oh, but he can help shield the others with one of his abilities. He has this thing that he just drops it on the ground and it'll provide slightly better protection for any soldiers near him. That isn't really that essential, and I don't know if there is any documented use. Your teammates get killed pretty easily from the stupidest of reasons, so, and you know, they're not real players. In multiplayer it would matter, but in Galactic Conquest it wouldn't matter. And there's one other thing he has this recon droid where he just place it somewhere, like you stand completely still and you remote control a tiny droid and shoot people with it, or just look around. But there's no point in sending it. The problem with Battlefront 2 and that type of weapon is that the map is too small to get any use of that. Most maps are too small to get any use out of that, and you would have much better luck getting inside a vehicle and running over whoever's getting in your way, checking out the place. If it's too crowded, then, well, don't, you know, just run away in the vehicle, or fight them anyways, because it's not like something like a Counter-Strike where you have to wait 3 minutes for the next round. If you mess up and die, you immediately take control of another soldier and say, okay, well, that wasn't a good idea, and continue playing. The recon droid is probably the most useless weapon in the entire game. And it's not dedicated to just the commander. Like, the Magna Guards have it. The droids have the Magna Guard. They have it. The Rebels have the Wookiees. They have it. And the whatchamacallums, the Imperial officers have them as well. But the thing is that in the case of the Wookiee and the Imperial officer, they have much better primary weapons, and they have other secondary weapons as well. And the Magna Guard also had, the Magna Guard is just garbage, because that I'm not even, I'll get to him when the time comes. I in general do not recommend playing the droids for any reason, but so don't worry about what they have, though I'll get to them. And finally, we have the jet trooper. Self-explanatory, halfway at least, but notice the gun he's carrying. So that is basically kind of like a rocket launcher, except it does less damage, like does like half the damage or something, and you can't do critical hits with it. You can't, let's say, it doesn't, there's no homing aspect. If you miss, you miss. You can't lock onto a target with this. However, the funny thing is that besides its, besides the fact that you're more agile and you have a semi-decent weapon, that is actually more effective than you might think. The EMP launcher, if I recall correctly, is basically a direct insult to the droids' droidica. If you don't know what that is, that's basically the robot that rolls around and has a shield and can come up and deploy a shield around itself. This will basically go right through that and kill them. So that negates any advantage they had if you're playing as one of these guys. As if they weren't already useless enough, as droidicas can't even get into other vehicles. They don't have any explosives. They don't have anything except their primary weapon and their shield, and being able to move faster. But the jet trooper has the ability to fly, and that is its own mobility that is much more advantage than a much bigger advantage than simply moving fast. Let me give you a few examples.
So, order, sir.
In Geonosis, you have a lot of mountainous area. You have this one mountainous area that the enemy has to climb up through a mountain. Like, they have to climb up a hill just to capture one of the command posts. And but the jet trooper can just fly over that hill and directly go in a straight line towards wherever he wants to go. The same applies to a place like maybe Yavin 4. There's a few hilly areas. Kamino has a bunch of like bottomless pits that you can fall into if you're not careful, and you can just avoid those by flying over them. There's probably a couple of other places where they could have their niche abilities. But yeah, so with units of the mostly covered, I'll talk about the other teams afterwards. Let's go on to, before we go on to businesses, let's talk about bonuses. Let's talk about the main objectives. So there's two game modes in Galactic Conquest. You take over stuff, you take over planets, or you get intercepted by the enemy fleet who's either protecting a planet or he's caught you in the same area as wherever he wants to be, and that's space assault. So Conquest, you got a bunch of planets, you got like four, you got a bunch of planets and you want to take over all of them. And when you do that, you have a battle where it is 150 versus 150, and you got the two teams going, you got two teams going against each other, and they're, 150 versus 150 soldiers. And there's like several, there's a standard of six command posts that you'd have to take over. Command posts are responsible for where the troops get deployed, where you can spawn from. And the more you have, the better. Now, besides the geographical advantage that may be inherent by just being able to corner the enemy, there is a more important advantage of the fact that the more you have, the faster their reserve, their troop reserves, get depleted. You see, it's not 150 soldiers deployed all at once, of course. It is 32 versus 32, or 24 versus 24, or 16 versus 16, depending on which version of this game you have. PC, I'm pretty sure, is 32 versus 32, or something really close to that. At least that's how I, that's usually what it is. Unless, some exceptions that'll raise it for one team. And, Xbox has 24 versus 24, PS2 has 16 versus 16, I think. So, they need to spawn, the soldiers need to spawn, right? And they have, and every time they spawn, they're basically using one of those slots, because when they get killed, one of those slots in the troop reserves, because when they get killed, that number decrements. Once it reaches like one troop, like one troop left, you can keep spawning, but the moment that one of your guys on your team dies, the game is over. So if you have, let's say, both teams only have one troop reserve, and they're it's all down to whoever kills one of the enemy first to win the game. It doesn't matter that both of you guys are down to one. If one of you guys on either team was to die, that's it. Whoever reached zero loss and whoever still has that one troop reserve wins. So keep that in mind. Do not and when you capture more than half the command posts, the enemy's reserves slowly decrements regardless of if their team is dying or not. So they can all be huddled up in some corner where they can't be reached. They like, even in multiplayer, like, let's say some dude managed to figure out a part where he's unkillable. He can't shoot anyone from there, but he's unkillable. And he's got the entire team just hiding there. He says, ha, they can't get us. They're forced into a stalemate. Nah, it doesn't work like that, because they still have to defend their command posts, or try to get the enemy's command posts. So, that's another thing to consider. When you have more than three, the enemy reserves decrement. If you have less than three, and more precisely, the enemy has more than three, then your troop reserves will decrease. Until, of course, you have reached the amount that's currently alive. So let's say you have managed to capture 5 out of 6 command posts, and for whatever reason, it's the population, the troop reserves on the enemy team have decremented to like 12, and there is exactly 12 enemies remaining. Well, in that case, it's not going to decrement any further. But if you capture all 6 or all 7, then you're going to get you're going to get an automatic victory condition, assuming the enemy team doesn't take one of those back in the next 20 seconds. If you capture all command posts, you're guaranteed a victory. Even if you have only one soldier left and they have like 140 allies, they got like somehow the enemy managed to kill all of your team except you, and you don't have any troops left, if you capture all 6, you can still win. And believe me, it has happened. Scenarios like this can happen. It's happened to me where on a planet like Naboo, thankfully the artificial intelligence is somewhat stupid, and they were looking in all the wrong areas, and I was able to capture all 6. Partly because by the time I killed half the ones that were looking in the wrong area, the other half, for some reason, were, as I described before, they were huddled up in one area, and by the time I reached the last command post, they were still huddled up in that area, and they thought it was a good idea to just stay there and try and shoot me from there. So, that's is important. You can either win by killing everyone or just capturing all the command posts. Command posts can vary from 4 to 7. You don't have 8, you don't have 3. And the reason I said previously precisely that it must actually own those command posts is that some maps, such as Dagobah, will have areas that are not controlled by anyone by default. Like, you'll have one for you and one for the enemy, but the other 4 are not controlled. So they're white. They're like labeled as white instead of red or blue. So that means that until if you unless you actually have a majority. So let's say if I capture four, but there and there's like one red and one white left, you're still gonna decrement the enemy team. But if you have, let's say, three command posts under your control, and the enemy only has one or two, that doesn't necessarily, that's not a majority still. It actually needs to be a total majority. All right. So, with that out of the way, let's talk about how the assault works. Let's say I'm flying all the way over here. Okay, I fly my guy all the way over here, and then you end up getting like you get into a space battle with them, right? So in that case, you're doing that space assault mission. Well, what are the objectives for that? The objective would be not just to shoot everyone, because you can do that. If you destroy a spaceship, you get 4 points. And oh yeah, there's no troop reserve system, by the way. Keep that in mind. You theoretically could have an infinite amount of troops. They could, if they were constantly like killing themselves and just crashing into stuff, that would count as a negative point, and it wouldn't count in favor of either of you. Like, both of your teams are doing suicidal stuff for some reason. Where the real objective is to acquire points. It's a point-based system. You shoot someone normally, not in a vehicle, just shoot someone, and it's an enemy, you get 1 point. If you shoot someone in a ship, you get 4 points. And if it's a ship with multiple people, then it's like 1 point additional per extra person. So like bombers on the stormtrooper and the other dude, what's it called? The stormtroopers and the rebels, they can have two people in a bomber. That would be 5 points if you destroy one of those. And then there's those flight carriers that can carry multiple people. Like the rebels and clones have the LAAT, they got 4 people. They can carry 4 people, so that would be 7 points. And the Empire and droids can carry something way larger, like 8 people, I think. And you would get 11 points for that. And besides this, the enemy and you should have an even amount of frigates that help defend your capital ship and you from the enemy starfighters, because they got a bunch of auto turrets on them and stuff. And yeah, I got a bunch of auto turrets. You destroy those, they get 18 points for each one destroyed. If so, specifically on clone versus Confederate, Republic versus Confederate, some maps can have, some space battles can have 3 frigates each, so that's pretty nice. But on Empire and Rebels, it's either 1 or 2. Besides destroying frigates, oh, by the way, the total score is 180 points. But besides destroying frigates, you gotta destroy the 5 essential parts of the ship. Those are the engines, life support, communications array, bridge, and something else I missed probably. Sensors array. Yeah, sensors array. So, each of those also grants 18 points. Keep that in mind. Some other things you should probably do in order to advance your causes would be to destroy the auto turn defense systems by going inside the ship and blowing those up. That will guarantee that you achieve weaker defenses. And if you destroy this, you can destroy the shields from the inside. It takes 4 of the time bombs instead of 3. That's a nuisance, but it's there. There's just like ammo droids and stuff you can restock, and killing people will give you ammo pickups eventually. So that's all there is to it. Get you 180 points. There's some different map configurations, but you once you've seen the 3 or 4, you've seen them all. There's more than that, but like for this particular scenario, clones versus droids, there's like 3 or 4, and then for Empire versus Rebels, there's probably like 2 or 3. Okay, let me address the bonuses. So, energy boost, this is just a stamina boost. You regen it way faster. That doesn't matter, it's the least important bonus. Supply bonus, you get like 3 times the ammo for everything. Garrison bonus, you get like 30 or 40 extra troops, depending, and you only get them when your troop reserve count reaches into the low 30s, low 30s, and it boosts it to like 60. Or maybe if it goes down to, you're like a 28 reverse reserve troops, it'll go up to 60. Auto turrets, you get stronger than the sniper auto turrets placed at every command post, but they're somewhat easy to destroy. They can be useful though on maps that don't have that many vehicles, or like no vehicles at all, like Dagobah or whatever. Back to tank, this is just health regen. It's kind of slow, but it's useful. Combat shielding, you get like an extra sliver of health on top of your full tank. So you get like, instead of 100% health, you start off with 120% health. Sabotage bonus, you get to blow up the other person's vehicles and get them down to like 30% health. Keep in mind, not all maps that you'd expect them to work could work. One map in particular I know doesn't work. Magito doesn't work. Enhanced blaster bonus. This feels like placebo. Apparently it makes your guns do more damage, but it doesn't really feel like it. And leader bonus. You get to play as one of the special characters, like the Jedi or whatever, or something like that. And to emphasize that, or like to give you a couple of examples, was it? No, deselect. Coruscant dude, get is a Mace Windu. If you have that selected, if you have Tatooine, it's gonna be, I actually don't remember Tatooine. I think it's Obi-Wan. And it's probably, I don't even know. This one is Obi-Wan for sure. This is probably Yoda. I don't care about the others. The point is that they're all the lightsaber guys. Now let's quickly go to the other classes real quick, because this video is already too long and the audio on the previous recording got corrupted. So, this guy can go invisible. He's got the sabotage bombs like the space pilots do, and he can heal others. He dies pretty quick though. Wookiee, this guy is a meat shield, and he's got a grenade launcher, and he's got the recon droid, and he's got the 4 grenades. Also, his Wookiee caster is basically both a shotgun and a sniper, depending on how you charge it. Shotgun if you just tap it, sniper if you're just holding down. Oh, and then keep in mind that with this, only the clones have all the Jedi people. with the rebel dudes, they have the worst roster because characters like Princess Leia occupy some of the planets, like for Polis Moss or whatever. And in some planets, it doesn't make sense to use the leader bonus at all. Like in Hoth, where you have to run around and stuff. In a planet like Coruscant, though, is a very good idea because you get Luke Skywalker and he just stabs everyone. You can stab like 50 people in a match and quickly end the game. And then last but not least, these guys that are strongest in the space battles, the Empire, and I should probably talk about the droids too, but hold on. Imperial officer, they got okay weapons. This guy has his glue gun, his Geonosian gun, and the grenade launcher. And the recon droid, this guy is the fastest man alive because of his jetpack. It doesn't work like a regular jetpack. You can just fly around. And like it's like a second sprint in practice. Very good for speedrunning the campaign with that guy whenever you have access to him. And then, these guys, the robot guys. This is just a weak guy with a grenade launcher. He dies pretty fast, and his other weapon isn't that useful too because it's easily dodged. This guy is even more useless because I don't think he can't even get into vehicles. And of previously discussed points, he's just horrible. He actually can jump that, but not very well. And in both Empire and these guys have an okay roster of heroes, but I don't know. We'll just end it here. The video was already too long, and I've delayed this multiple times, and it's going to get like 30 views anyways. So, thanks for watching. See you guys later.